Good morning students, welcome back to your maths class. Today we are going to start our new chapter frequency distribution. This comes under the unit statistics. This is your unit 5 and chapter number is 15, frequency distribution. Before we start the chapter and understand what is frequency distribution, let us talk about what is statistics first. Okay, now to start with, we are going to see that what is a data. This word data means that whatever fact we are collecting or whatever information we are collecting in a numerical figure, this is known as data. Like if we are talking or if you are collecting information about anyone's age or the number of students in a class, or we are talking about the wages of workers, that means we will be collecting the information in numbers, and that information when we collect is known as data. Now, there are two types of data. First is primary data and second, of course, is secondary data. Okay, now the primary data, the investigator, like if I am investigating and I am collecting the data, so that data collected by the investigator himself is known as primary data. And if the data is collected by someone else other than the investigator, then that data is known as the secondary data. Okay, now next is variable. We know that what is a variable? A quantity which can take any value or which can take different values is known as variable. Here we can divide variable in two type, or we can have two types of variable. That is, one is continuous, first one, and the second one is discontinuous or discrete. So there are two types of variable. Now, continuous, if for a given range means if you're talking about 1 to 10, for a given range, if the variable can take any value, then it is known as continuous. And if for the given range the variable cannot take all the values, then it is known as the discrete. Now, continuous variable meaning that it can take any value. Now, if we talk about the wages of the worker, let's say we are talking about the wages of the worker between 100 rupees to 500 rupees. So between 100 and 500, it can take any value, no restriction. It can take any value, and that's why the wages of a worker will be a continuous variable. Height of a worker, or height of a person, not worker, but height of a person, it can take any value, 7.5, 6.5, 5.5, could anything, you know, the height could be anything, and that's why it will be a continuous variable. Likewise, if you come for discrete variable, discrete variable means it is restricted, it will not take any value. We are talking about the number of members in a family. It can be like if you take a range or like 1 to 10, so the number of members in a family could be 2, could be 4, could be 7, but it cannot be 4.5. It cannot take the value 3.5. That means here it is not taking all the values, and that's why the number of members in a family would be a discrete variable. The number of students in a class, the number of workers in a factory, this is all discrete value. Okay, now so here you have learned the difference between continuous variable and discrete variable. So I think I should take a question given in your exercise 15 so that it would be more clear to you all. This is question number 6. Now, if you question, I'll be taking few question parts. Like they are asking weights of a player of a volleyball team. So weight of a player, it can take any value, you know, it can be 40.5, it can be 80.5, it can be 90, it can be 99. That means there is no restriction, so it will be a continuous variable. Likewise, if it is saying number of car accidents in a city, so number of car accidents, there could be 2 car accident, 3 car accident, it cannot be 2.5. that means it cannot take any value possible. So that means it will come under, or it will be a discrete variable. One more I am going to take, time taken by runners in a race. So the time taken by runners could be anything, 4.5 seconds, 10.5 seconds, anything, or 11 seconds. So there is no restriction on the values, and that's why it will come under the continuous variable. And that's how you can simplify all the parts given in question number 6. Then we have this statistics. whatever data, whether primary or secondary, we are getting, and if we are writing the data, the science which deals with the gathering of data, collection of data, representation of data, and then analysis of data. This science which deals, okay. Now next we have, after this data, we have the statistics. The science which deals with the collection of data, representation of data, that how are we collecting the data, now how are we going to represent the data, and after that the analysis of data. This science is known as the statistics. Now let us say that we are collecting data in a class. We are talking about the marks of the students present in the class. Let's say there are 10 students in the class in total, and we are going to write the information of their marks. Let's say first students has got this 4 marks, then 6 marks, 3 marks, 8, 4, right. Then we have this 9, 8, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So there are 10 students, and these are the marks of each student out of 10. This is the marks they have got, okay. So this information which we have gathered in figure or in numerical figure, this is known as data. Now here, whatever data we have collected, this is known as the raw data, because there is no arrangement, there is no specification. It is just that we have gathered all the information, and that's why it is known as the raw data, or you can call it ungrouped data. That means there is no specification, no arrangement, okay. We don't know that which is the least value or the minimum value, which is the maximum value. We have to go through it, and how many times a number is occurring, more than once, okay. Now here, if you see, we can arrange this raw data. There could be an arrangement. We can arrange from in ascending order, or we can arrange it in descending order. And when we arrange it in ascending order or descending order, that will be known as array of the data. A-R-R-A-Y. Array means this, it means sajavat, okay. That means we are going to arrange the raw data in either ascending order or the descending order. So let us arrange it. Now ascending order, so first it will give you 3, and then I guess 4. How many times 4? 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. Then we have 5, 1 time. Then we have 6, 1, 2. 2 times we have 6. There is no 7. 8 is occurring twice. And then 9 is occurring once. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Okay. Now we have arranged this raw data in ascending order. You can write it in descending order as well, no problem. So we have arranged it in ascending order. This is the array of data, and after you have written the data in the ascending order, now what can we do? We can find the minimum value, which is 3. We can find the maximum value, which is 9. And when you subtract or the find out the difference between the maximum value and the minimum value, that will be known as range. So they can ask you to calculate the range. Range means, if you have arranged the data, the difference between the maximum value, which is here, is 9, and the minimum value here, which is 3. So this will give you the range. Okay. Now after this range, we have another term, frequency. See, we are talking about the numbers of 10 students, the marks of 10 students. And if you see, there are many marks which is occurring more than once. So any marks which is occurring, how many times it is occurring, that is known as frequency. Like if I ask you, what is the frequency of 4? It is 3, because it is occurring 3 times, no? What is the frequency of 6? 2. What is the frequency of 5? 1. What is the frequency of 8? 2. Frequency of 9? 1. So this is the term frequency. How many times a number is repeating itself? And then comes the term after this, frequency distribution, okay. Now when you have collected the data, you have arranged the data, now frequency distribution, how to write or how to represent this data and the frequency written in the tabular form. When you just write all this information in a tabular form, you make a table, and that will be known as the frequency distribution. That means here in this chapter we have to do nothing, but to calculate the data what we are given with. We have to arrange the data. We are going to see further that how are we going to arrange the data. We have to write the frequency, and also we have to make the tally marks, which we will learn, and that tabular representation will be our frequency distribution. Now, after this raw data, we have another type. We have this grouped data. Now, to understand this, I'm going to take again the example of the marks obtained by students present in the class. Let's say the marks are 3, 4, 6, 8, 1, 2, 4, 8, 6, 7, 5, 3, 4, 8, 2. Okay, so let me count how many students are there. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. So there are 15 students. I have written the marks obtained by all 15 students each. Okay, now since I have just gathered this information, so it will be a raw data. Now, if we arrange it in the ascending order, that will be the array of the data. You can arrange it in ascending or descending order. Here, I am going to arrange it in ascending order. One is occurring only once. So, now for this was our raw data. We have arranged the raw data and this arrangement in ascending order. It is our array. And now we can arrange this raw data or this ungrouped data in a more condensed form, making the intervals, class intervals. Like here we have, what can we do? We can make, or we can now arrange it further, the marks obtained by students between 0 to 5. Like under this, we will be writing the number of students who have scored between this 0 to 5. Like if you see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So these are the students, 8 students who have scored between 0 to 5. So we will write 8. So now we have written more condensed form. Now further, 5 to 10. Now 5 to 10, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So there are 7 students who have scored between, or who have got the numbers between 5 to 10. So this is the another form. Here we have written the data in more condensed form. So it is easy to see, easy to read, easy to evaluate. So this is known as the grouped data. If we write the data in a more condensed form, that is known as the grouped data. And for that we need class intervals. If you see, we have made the class intervals. That is having two numbers. This number on the left hand side is known as lower limit. Okay, and this one on the right hand side is known as the upper limit. Like if I'm writing it 10 to 15, this is one class interval in which the lower limit is, by the way, this together is known as class limit, and this one is the lower class limit, and this one is the upper class limit. Now further, we can categorize the group data in two. One is exclusive form and the other one is inclusive form. Exclusive form. Now here you need to be very careful. First is exclusive form, also known as continuous form. It is called exclusive form or continuous form. Why are we calling it exclusive form or continuous form? It is a frequency distribution, let's say like 10 to 20, this is one class interval. Then we have 20 to 30, then we have 30 to 40, 40 to 50. I hope you are understanding that these are the class intervals. The lower limit is 10, the upper limit is 20 for this class. For this third class, if I tell you what is the lower limit, 30. What is the upper limit? 40. And these are the class intervals having the range, or you can say class size 10, because 10 to 20 the class size would be 10. Now why it is called continuous form? Because it is 10 to 20, it is ending at 20 and now starting from 20, ending at 30, starting from 30. So this seems a little continuous and it is known as continuous form. Why exclusive? Because here in the first class or second class or any class, we just take the values we'll take the lower limit, that means we'll take the values including 10, but we will not include 20. So the lower limit will be included, but the upper limit will be excluded, and that's why we are having this exclusive form. Here if you talk about 30 to 40, 30 will be included. If a number is 30, we will take it here. But if a number is 40, we will not take, because the lower limit will be included, but the upper limit will not be included. It is excluded, and that's why it is known as exclusive form. If it is not clear, we are going to simplify further the questions. It will be clear further. But just simple, exclusive, why? Because we take the lower limit, we do not take the upper limit, we exclude the upper limit, and that's why it is called the exclusive form. Now this is one type. Then we have the second type. Second type is inclusive form. Inclusive means we are going to include something, and it is known as discontinuous. Okay, now in this the class intervals would be of type 0 to 10. You could have started 10 to 20. I'm just writing it there. 0 to 10, and then we have 11 to 20, then 21 to 30, then 31 to 40, like this. Now here you see why it is called first, why it is called discontinuous, because here it is ending at 10 but not starting with 10. It is ending at 20 but not starting with 20. So it seems a little discontinuous, and that's why it is known as discontinuous form. Why inclusive? Because here in any class interval, we will take, or we will include both the values. We will take 0 as well as we will take 10. That means we will include both the lower limits and the upper limits. Like here, if you talk about the third one, 21 to 30. The lower limit is 21 and upper limit is 30. We will include both. Here in this class, 21 to 30, we will take all the values including this 21 and 30. And since both the boundaries or both the limits are included, that's why we call it inclusive form. Okay. Now, let's go back to exclusive form. Exclusive form is 10 to 20. Also known as continuous form, 20 to 30, 30 to 40. I am writing only three class intervals. Now here if you see why it is known as exclusive, because we are excluding the upper limit. We don't take the value 20, we don't take the value 30 here. Now if we talk about the true upper limit, so in exclusive form or true lower limit, this one is your true lower limit and true upper limit. If I ask you the third interval, what is the true lower limit? It is 30. True upper limit, it would be 40. So exclusive form, it is okay. Now let's talk about the inclusive form. What will be the true upper limits or true lower limits? We have the inclusive form. Inclusive form meaning 1 to 10 or discontinuous form. In this, we include both the upper limit and the lower limit, 1 to 10, 11 to 20, 21 to 30. Now here how to calculate the true upper limit or true lower limit. If I write it for you once so that you can see, true lower limit, and then we will be calculating true upper limit. If it was given exclusive form, then it is okay than 10 to 20 or 20 to 30. So this will be your true lower limit and this will be your true upper limit. But here in this inclusive form, you have to calculate. You see, let's take this class. Okay. Now this class, if you want to calculate the lower limit means this, the value lower limit and then the upper limit. To calculate the lower limit, we have to take the lower value or this value here, 11, plus the upper value of the previous class. Are you all getting? The lower value of this class and the upper value of this class, which is 10 divided by 2, is coming. 10 plus 11 is 21 divided by 2 will be your 10.5. Now this 10.5 will be the true lower limit of this class and true upper limit of this class. I hope you can understand. See, it is coming 10.5, which is less than 11. So it will be the true lower limit of this class, and 10.5, which is greater than 10. So it will be true upper limit for this previous class. Got it? Likewise, if you are going to calculate the true upper limit of this class, upper limit means this 20 is your upper value, no? So 20 and the lower limit of this class, which is 21 divided by 2. So this will give you 41 by 2. It's simple, 20.5. So 20.5 will be the true upper limit for this class. But then 20.5 will be the true lower limit of this class. Hope it is clear. You to calculate the true upper limit or true lower limit for any class, for any particular class, if we want to calculate true upper limit or true lower limit, we take, if it is lower limit, we take the lower value plus the upper value of the previous class divided by 2. That's how we calculate the true lower limit. And to calculate the upper limit again, we have to take this value plus this value 21 divided by 2, and that will be the true upper limit. Okay. And now next we have this class size. If you want to calculate the class size can be calculated by subtracting true upper limit minus true lower limit, and that will be your class size. Okay, next we have class mark. How to calculate a class mark? It is true upper limit. I am not going to write true upper limit again and again. I am writing this short form. TUL stands for true upper limit plus true lower limit divided by 2. Every time when you are asked to calculate the class marks, you can simply calculate by adding the two, true upper limit, true lower limit divided by 2. Likewise, if they are asking you to calculate the class size, it is the difference of true upper limit minus true lower limit. Clear? Now we have our exercise 15 of the questions which are given from 1 to 7 are easy theoretical. Like they are asking question number 2nd or 1st, they are asking define statistics. Then they are asking what are primary data and secondary data we have learned. Then there is fill in the blanks. The difference between the maximum and minimum observation. So the maximum observation, let's say 6, 7, 7, 8 and 9. So the difference between the maximum and the minimum observation. So the difference, if you remember that this only is known as range. The difference of maximum value and minimum value is known as the range. Like if we are given with 16 to 20 and they are asking you have to write the upper limit of this class interval. So upper limit would be 20. So these fill in the blanks you can do on your own. Then we have question number 4. Question number 4, you are given with a data 5 part 1. If you see 5, 7, 16, 21, 8 and 10. They are asking you to calculate the range. Just now we have learned that how to calculate range, the maximum value minus the minimum value. So here if you see, the maximum value is 21 minus the minimum value is 5. And then if you are supposed to calculate, it would be 60. Okay. Likewise, we have this question number 5, which is important. So we are going to solve question number 5. Here in this question, if you see, they have given the class mark. How do we calculate the class mark? Remember, class mark can be calculated by the formula true lower limit plus true upper limit divided by 2. That means this 28 is your class mark and it is calculated by using the true lower limit. Any class and then true upper limit. Let's say A and B, this is your class interval. So true lower limit will be A, true upper limit will be B, and then divide plus and divided by 2. This is how we have calculated. So if you see these, there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 class mark given, can be calculated, or it was calculated using this formula. That means there would be 5 class interval. I hope you all are getting it. Those who are not getting, no problem, you will see. Okay. So that means now this is the class mark calculated by the first class interval. So we are going to calculate the first class interval, what it could be. To calculate that, you see, whatever information is given, each of the two numbers are having a difference of 6. Like 28 plus 6 will be 34. 36, 40, 40 plus 6, 46, 46 plus 6, 52. That means if you see what could be the class size, it is 6, because every time the difference is 6. Now we know the class size. So we are talking about the first class interval. Let's say that for first class interval, the true lower limit, or I'm just writing the lower limit is A. The lower limit, like 10 to 20 we write now, so 10 is your lower limit. Now likewise, we don't know what is a class interval, so we are taking lower limit as A. Now since the class size is 6, that means if one is 10, the other one will be 16. 6, the difference is 6. So what could be the upper limit? If A is your lower limit and the difference is 6, so the upper limit will be A plus 6, isn't it? So now we know the upper lower limit, the true upper limit, so we can apply the formula for the class mark. I am writing the formula here, class mark. The formula is true lower limit plus true upper limit divided by 2. Now you see, true lower limit is A plus true upper limit is your A plus 6 divided by 2, and this is your for your first class interval. And what is the class mark of the first class interval? Is 28, correct? Now 28 equals to, this is A plus A, 2A plus 6 divided by 2. Now you see, in the numerator we have 2A plus 6. You can take 2 common. So from in the numerator I'm taking 2 common. So this will be A plus 3 divided by 2. This 2 and this 2 will get cancelled, and this is 28. So this is 28 equals A plus 3, or simply A is coming, 28 minus 3 will give you 25. What was A? We have taken A as true lower limit. So A is coming, the lower limit is coming 25, and the difference is 6, class size is 6. So if it is 25, so what will be the upper limit? 31, isn't it? Because the lower limit is coming 25, and the difference every time the class size is 6. So one is 25, the other one, the upper limit would be 31. Then it could be this for the second one. If you see, it will be 31. The difference is 6, class size is 6, so it will be 37, isn't it? Next will be 37 plus 6. Will be 43. Then we have 43 to 49. Remember, the maximum value is 52. So next would be 49 and plus 6 will be 55. And that is sufficient. We are not supposed to write further, because the maximum value is 52, which will come under this. So this is how we have written the class size, which was coming 6, and the class interval. Okay.